Well, welcome once again to class. This is the Tabernacle of David and lesson number 10. We're going to be talking today about the order of worship that was given to David by the Lord, and this was a pattern that was carried out throughout the history of Israel. And then we're going to take a look at the specific type of worship that I believe that is pleasing to the Lord. In other words, we're going to be talking about the divine order of worship. Let's open up our class with prayer and just pray that the Spirit of God will quicken our minds and our hearts, our spirits, that we can receive what the Lord has for us today. Father, in Jesus' name, we're grateful to you for the opportunity that we have to come together to study your word and to receive an impartation of your Holy Spirit. Quicken us, we pray, by your Holy Spirit. Quicken our spirit. Quicken our minds. In Jesus' name. Amen. According to the commandment of David. Now, this is the 10th week, and of course, throughout these past 9 weeks, we have hopefully laid a good foundation as to what the Tabernacle of David is, and we won't belabor the point by going back and doing any extensive review. But very quickly, let me just share with you some of the aspects of the Tabernacle of David. Now, by this time, you ought to be able to draw the contrast between the Tabernacle of David and the Tabernacle of Moses. Keep in mind that the Tabernacle of Moses was the order of God that was to be in place until the fulfillment at the cross of Calvary. Now, what was the significance of the Tabernacle of David? Well, first of all, I believe that the Tabernacle of David gives us that open window that just allows us to look into the future. It was just a small period of time of 30 to 35 years that the Tabernacle of David was actually functioning in the nation of Israel. But of course, we know that Amos the prophet prophesied that once again the Lord would restore the Tabernacle of David. In Acts chapter 15, we know that James stood up and quoted Amos the prophet and said that the Lord would restore the Tabernacle of David. So if the Lord is going to restore the Tabernacle of David, then we need to understand what the Tabernacle of David is all about. So again, the actuality of the Tabernacle of David was just a very small window in the period of the Old Testament. Essentially, what was associated with the Tabernacle of David, first of all, was the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the presence of the Lord. We could term that as the glory of the Lord. We could speak of it as being the very embodiment of God in a symbol or in a type. Now, of course, we realize that the fullness of the dwelling place of God is in the temple, which we are. We're the temple of the Holy Spirit. But the Tabernacle of David was just simply a tent that was pitched, and a tent meaning a temporary dwelling place. It was established on Mount Zion, and again, it was for the specific purpose of enhousing the Ark of the Covenant. Now keep in mind, at the very same time, the Tabernacle of Moses was functioning, and that was in Mount Gibeon. So the Tabernacle of Moses was in Mount Gibeon. The Tabernacle of David was in Mount Zion. The Tabernacle of David had the Ark of the Covenant. The Tabernacle of Moses did not. There was solemnity that was associated with the Tabernacle of Moses, while there was joy and rejoicing associated with the Tabernacle of David. So that, in a nutshell, is pretty much the summarization of the contrast between the two covenants. And both of these are pointing toward a greater fulfillment. And first of all, the Tabernacle of Moses was to be fulfilled at the cross of Calvary through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. But you have to understand that Acts chapter 15 is after the cross, which means that whatever is associated with the tabernacle of David that is to be restored was after the cross. So that's the reason why it's applicable to us, that we have to understand that this is an order that was ordained of God, and it was not finished, it was not completed at the cross. Therefore, it becomes very significant to us as Christians 2,000 years later. And I believe that this order of worship is the order of worship in the church that is going to bring about a great time of honoring the Lord and a great time of joy in the body of Christ. Now, there's no question none whatsoever concerning where David got this whole concept. He got it from God. It was a pattern that God had given to him, a revelation. And the revelation was primarily the order of worship surrounding the Ark of the Covenant or the presence of the Lord. Now, here's a significant thing that we're going to be talking about today, and that is the title of our lesson is According to the Commandment of David. The godly kings of Israel always restored the order of worship that was established by David the king in the tabernacle of David. And I'm going to go through several scriptures here to show you that there are many references made back to the commandment of David. Now, again, what's this commandment? It's concerning worship. And I want this to be strongly embedded in our spirit, because this is not just some neat little theory that we can talk about or something that is just simply a historical fact, but it's an ongoing order of worship. And it's really amazing when you really study the Word of God with a bit of insight. Sometimes it may just be a simple revelation that just opens up the Word of God, and you realize that there are so many things in the Word of God that maybe we just passed over. We read over it and we didn't really understand what was being said. But we're going to go through a brief history of Israel and see how this applies to the commandment that was given to David. The commandment given to David was concerning spiritual worship. The tabernacle of David was established somewhere around 1048 B.C. And we can find this, the scriptural references, 1 Chronicles 15 and 16. David appointed and ordained singers and musicians to sing and play before the Lord in his tabernacle. David appointed certain of the Levites to be singers with instruments of music, psalteries and harps and cymbals, sounding by lifting up the voice with joy. These were to minister before the ark of the Lord continually as every day's work required. Now, again, ultimately, the presence of God or the Ark of the Covenant dwells on the inside of us, the body. The scripture says that ye are the body of Christ. Ye are the temple of God. Now, that means individually as well as corporately, probably more so corporately, but we do understand that each individual body is the inhousing of the Holy Spirit, the presence of God. But all of us together corporately as the body of Christ represent the temple of God, and that is where true worship ought to take place. Now, we can worship God anytime, any place, in any situation, but the most effective worship is when we assemble ourselves together as a body and we offer up thanksgiving and praise unto God, and we extol him for his great mercies that he has bestowed upon us. But in the meantime, between the tabernacle of David and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit within our body and the extension of the body of Christ in the earth was the Temple of Solomon. Now, the Temple of Solomon was established about 1012, so that's a period of about 36 years. Solomon built the temple according to the pattern given to David, his father. You recall that David wanted to build the temple, but God said, "You're a man of war, and your son will build it, but it'll be according to your pattern, or the pattern that I give to you." When the day of the dedication of the temple came, singers and musicians had a vital part. This is when the staves were taken out of the eyelets on each side of the Ark of the Covenant. And of course, the staves were for the purpose of transporting the Ark of the Covenant. Keep in mind that here you had this long pole that went through these rings on both sides of the Ark of the Covenant, and you had a priest on each end of these staves. And again, that was for the transporting of the Ark of the Covenant. But when the staves were taken out, that meant that the Ark of the Covenant, the physical Ark of the Covenant, had found its final resting place in the Temple of Solomon. As soon as the priest came out of the holy place, the singers and musicians began to minister before the Lord as they stood on the east end of the brazen altar. And 2 Chronicles chapter 5, 11 through 14, let's read that together. "And it came to pass, when the priests were come out of the holy place, for all the priests that were present were sanctified, and did not then wait the course. Also the Levites, which were the singers, all of them of Asaph, of Heman, of Jeduthun, with their sons and their brethren, being arrayed in white linen, having cymbals and psalteries and harps, stood at the east end of the altar, and with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. It came even to pass, as the trumpeters and singers were as one, to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, and praise the Lord, saying, For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever, that then the house was filled with the cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priest could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God." Now I want to just point out a couple of things here before we move on. It's very, very significant that the Word of God says, it came to pass as the trumpeters and singers were as one to make one sound to be made in praising and thanking the Lord. See, it's not the matter of competition, it's not the matter of entertainment, but it's a matter of blending together in one harmonious sound unto the Lord that's going to bring the presence of the Lord. "And when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever, then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priest could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God." Now, I do recall that there have been times throughout my life, even as a young boy, and times even in my own ministry, that there actually would be services where the presence of God would be so powerful that anything that man would say was just really insignificant. And that's not to say that when you stand up to preach, it's just man speaking, because the preacher ought to be anointed and should be the voice of the Lord with a particular word from God. Now, I have always considered myself to be a word preacher. I always put great value on the Word of God, and I believe it's very, very important. In fact, I believe that's probably one of the greatest things that should take place in a worship service. And again, the praise and worship that we offer up to the Lord is not the prelude to the preaching. It's not to prepare your hearts for the preaching of the Word. It is actual worship to God. And of course, it creates an atmosphere that will make it very conducive for the delivery of the Word of God and to bring the presence of God. or the sense of the presence of God into our midst, and we see many wonderful things that take place. Now, there is a mindset among many people who put such little emphasis on the preaching of the Word of God. In other words, they put so much emphasis on experience that oftentimes they will say, well, we had really a great service today because the preacher didn't even preach. Well, I understand that, and again, I have had many instances throughout my life where I have seen this to be the case. We had a renewal here at our local church probably about 7 or 8 years ago. It all started on a Sunday night when there just came a holy hush over the congregation. It was such a sense of the presence of the Lord, no one said anything. Our bishop was just standing in the presence of the Lord, and we were all in an attitude of worshiping from our heart. And there was not really any outward expression. It was a quiet. It was literally a holy quiet. And that presence became so powerful that we came together for 16 nights in a row, just came into the sanctuary with no opening remarks, just simply coming and sitting in the presence of the Lord. And I'm here to tell you that I have never in my life experienced any more powerful presence of the Lord than I did in those 16 nights that we now refer to as a renewal. It was something powerful. People were responding. As the Spirit of the Lord would move upon them, they would come and they would fall on their face before the Lord. People testified later of great healings. There were people who would pass by the church, and they said for some strange reason they just were drawn to come in. I remember one particular person who had come from out of town and came into the presence of the Lord, or just walked into the sanctuary during the day and felt such a powerful presence of the Lord. There was another instance where a medical doctor who practiced medicine about 25 miles from here had passed through, and she testified to Bishop Huskins that she felt this strong urgency just to come and to walk into the sanctuary. Now, that is a phenomenal thing. It doesn't happen every day, it doesn't happen every week. And in fact, there are many manifestations of the Spirit that are not really intended to be duplicated. Now, it's not to say that it should not be duplicated, just waiting in the presence of the Lord, being quiet before the Lord. But it has to be by the motivation of the Holy Spirit. It has to be by the direction of the Holy Spirit. And when there is such an awesomeness of the presence of the Lord, you will find that there is going to be a restoration and a renewal that's going to take place in the hearts of the people. But the key is to be of one mind, to be one voice, and that's really what happened on the day of Pentecost. They were in one mind, one accord, all in one place, and there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. It filled all the house where they were, and the Spirit of God came and set upon them. They began to speak in tongues, and the Spirit of the Lord gave them utterance. All of this, I believe, was contingent upon, first of all, being obedient to the commandment of the Lord to go and to wait until this visitation of the Spirit. But also to realize that it was, I believe, through the power of agreement, being of the same mind. And that's what God wants in the church. That's what God wants in ministry. I'm thinking now of a church that is a very significant church, has been and still is, but at one time had one of the greatest choirs anywhere. I mean, this was a nationally known choir that just absolutely was wonderful. I mean, it probably was one of the reasons why the church had grown as much as it had. But there developed almost like a competition between the choir director and the pastor, And it's almost like the choir director held the pastor in hostage because he realized how important the choir was, and it was almost like that he was taking charge. And that is a total wrong way of even, first of all, it's not a demonstration of some professionalism. It's not the demonstration of talent, but it is a legitimate ministry. And by the way, the pastor of the local church ought to be the chief worshiper. He ought to be the one that is the worshiper, and even the direction that he believes that the church ought to go in worship ought to be at his discretion by the direction of the Holy Spirit, of course. So the point being that musical directors, choir directors, praise and worship leaders should be in total agreement with the ministry of that house. And then and only then will God bless and will show himself in a mighty way through the manifestation of his presence. Now let's take a look at some specific historical events where a reference was made to David. Now I thought I had read this somewhere concerning Jehoshaphat, and I was just kind of scanning through the scripture before I came to class tonight or today, and I wasn't able to find this direct reference. But let's just go ahead and rehearse. And we've already talked about this on a couple of occasions in this class concerning King Jehoshaphat. When the Moabites and the Ammonites came to battle against Jehoshaphat, he went into the court and made intercession to God. The prophetic word of the Lord came. Jehoshaphat and the congregation fell before the Lord in worship. The Levites stood and began to praise the Lord with a loud voice. Now, whether this is in direct reference to King David or not, again, I don't recall. I'm not going to spend a lot of time trying to find this, but it's certainly a pattern that throughout the word of the Lord that there is a renewal of the form of worship that was put in order by King David. As I say, I'm not going to belabor the point. Okay, let's move on. Okay. The Levites stood and began to praise the Lord with a loud voice. Jehoshaphat sends singers ahead of the army. The Lord set ambushes against the enemy. They began to destroy one another. The people spent 3 days gathering the spoil of the enemy. Probably one of the most unique and strange strategies for war that's ever been recorded. You send singers out. You send Judah first. That's the key. And that is the reason why praise and worship becomes in one sense, where it becomes a form of warfare. And I'm not big into, quote, spiritual warfare, but I do know that what happens when you praise the Lord is that you are extolling the greatness of God. You're saying, God, you're the one and only God. You're the one who's due all the praise, the honor, and the glory. And it's a clear signal that is being sent to the powers of darkness that you are recognizing the one who is supreme above all, the God who is sovereign over all, even over the forces of evil. And so when you exalt the Lord, you're putting him in his rightful place, and you can expect God to show up. And when God shows up, the victory is ours. King Hezekiah, about 726 B.C., set himself to repair the house of the Lord and to reestablish worship in the house of the Lord. He also revived the ministry of the singers and musicians as ordained by David many years prior. And this, the reference here is in 2 Chronicles 29, 25 through 28. And he set the Levites in the house of the Lord with cymbals, with psalteries, and with harps, according to the commandment of David and of Gad the king's seer and Nathan the prophet. For so was the commandment of the Lord by his prophets. And the Levites stood with the instruments of David, and the priests with the trumpets, and Hezekiah commanded to offer the burnt offering upon the altar. And when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord began also with the trumpets and with the instruments ordained by David, king of Israel. And all the congregation worshiped, and the singers sang, and the trumpeters sounded, and all this continued until the burnt offering was finished. Now, what's the significance here? Hezekiah was one of those godly kings who sought to restore the proper order of worship in the nation of Israel. And that proper order of worship was by the commandment of King David. Now, King Josiah, who was another godly king, this is a couple hundred, well, about 100 years later, B.C. 623, the reference here, 2 Chronicles 35, 1 through 19. Josiah had the temple cleansed under the feast of Passover as Hezekiah had done previously. Josiah charged the priests and the Levites to prepare themselves after their course according to the writing of David, king of Israel, and according to the writing of his son Solomon. And the singers, the sons of Asaph, were in the place. You recall that Asaph was what was considered to be the chief musician. And the references of the true worship, the true Davidic worship throughout the ensuing years of the history of Israel has been a reference made to the sons of Asaph. So Asaph continued this priestly ministry through his sons, through his seed. The restoration of Judah, of course this was through Nehemiah and Ezra, when the order was given to prepare the way for the restoration of the temple after the captivity in Babylon. We find the account, of course, in both of the books of Ezra and Nehemiah. Keep in mind, Nehemiah was the governor. He represented the political order, while Ezra was the priest. So again, you had this king-priest combination. The first thing that was done in this restoration was the rebuilding of the temple. The temple foundation was laid in the Feast of Trumpets, the very feast in which the Temple of Solomon had been dedicated many years before. Ezra 2:65, beside their servants and their maids, of whom there were 7,337, this was the number of the total group, there were among them 200 singing men and singing women. And when the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, they set the priests in their apparel with trumpets, and the Levites, the sons of Asaph, with cymbals to praise the Lord after the ordinance of David, king of Israel. And they sang together by chorus in praising and giving thanks unto the Lord. Now, why were they giving thanks to the Lord? Because he is good, for his mercy endureth forever toward Israel. And all the people shouted with a great shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. Then in Nehemiah, and the chief of the Levites, Hashabiah, Sherebiah, and Jeshua, the son of Kadmiel, and their brethren over against them, to praise and to give thanks according to the commandment of David, the man of God, ward over against war. Now that's interesting, isn't it? According to the commandment of David, or according to the ordinance of David. Then Nehemiah 12:44-47 is really a repeat, pretty much, of establishing this order. Both the singers and the porters kept the word of their God and the word of the purification according to the commandment of David and of Solomon his son. For in the days of David and Asaph of old, there were chief of the singers and songs of praise and thanksgiving unto God. And all Israel in the days of Zerubbabel and in the days of Nehemiah gave the portions of the singers and the porters every day his portion, and they sanctified holy things unto the Levites, and the Levites sanctified them unto the children of Aaron. Now, I believe what is referred to here is that these singers and porters were ministers in the house of the Lord, and they received their portion, which meant that that was really their full-time occupation, just to worship the Lord. Now, I think sometimes that it's very honorable for a minister, a pastor, you know, to spend hours and hours, you know, in the presence of the Lord. That's very, very, very important. But by the same token, there is certainly much more ministry that's involved in the local church than just spending all of your time praying, reading the Bible, and so forth. But perhaps if there was more time spent in prayer, meditation, and study of the Word of God, we might have a greater sense of restoration and a sense of the presence of the Lord. And then again, Amos, in Amos chapter 9, verses 11 through 13, is a reference to the restoration of the tabernacle of David. Now, how does all of this apply to church history? In Acts chapter 15, of course, we see that the significance of the restoration of the tabernacle of David was the coming together of the Jews and the Gentiles, meaning that the middle wall of partition had been broken down, the veil had been rent, there was access into the Holy of Holies, and all of that transpired once and for all through the rending of the veil, through the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. But again, the tabernacle of David represented all of those things, maybe just in a portion or in a type. But it's also important to realize that Jesus referred to a new order of worship, which what he was saying was, you don't go to this mountain or that mountain. You don't go through the same ceremonies and the rituals of the old covenant, but there's a new order, and they that worship the Father must worship him in spirit and in truth, because God is a spirit, and there's really no way that you can communicate except by the Spirit. Now, I think sometimes people just may pray out of desperation. I used to tell my wife that, you know, sometimes that she would be in a situation, maybe a moment of fright, or she may think that somebody about ready to pull out in front of her. She'll say, "Jesus, Jesus," and I'll kid her sometimes, and I'll say, "You know, I think that's one of those nervous prayers." But still, yet we have that privilege of calling on the name of Jesus in our time of desperation. But true worship is in spirit and in truth. And we're going to take a closer look at that in just a moment. True worship consists of psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Now next week we're going to get into what I think is going to be a very interesting lesson, and that's going to be taking a brief look at, or taking a look at the brief history of music throughout the history of the church. There had been a lot of controversy throughout the centuries, and you know, we think in terms of people saying that there are certain modes of singing or certain modes of music in the church, There was a time, I suppose, that a guitar and a set of drums was just absolutely irreverent. It was something that was almost like blasphemy. I grew up, of course, in a more of a rural area, a small town rural area. And it was very common, I mean, you know, since I was just a little boy, to have guitars in church. So I grew up playing a guitar. And I never will forget that when I was in college, I was associated with a fraternity, Christian fraternity, associated with this particular organization. Well, it was a Pentecostal organization. And I never will forget, two of my best friends were very accomplished musicians. One, I think, played a trombone, the other played a trumpet, and they'd built a very successful church in Memphis. And they said something to the effect that they would never allow anyone to come into their church and play a guitar. I just basically said, if my guitar is not welcome, I'm not welcome. But things have changed, and now it's very common to have all kinds of stringed instruments and have drums and percussions. But these attitudes have evolved throughout the years. And even some of the denominations now that forbid any kind of musical instrument in the church really have a precedence in history because, as we'll see next week, that there were some very significant spiritual leaders who had the same idea. We think in terms of modern day, we think in terms, of course, of organs and pianos as being the holy instruments. But you know, there was a time, even after the Dark Ages, maybe in the time of John Wesley, in that period of time, where organs were considered to be like worldly. And the organs were ripped out of the church. And I'll give you more information on that next week. Now, I went to Brazil. I had the opportunity to go to Brazil and to minister with a friend of mine back in 1975, and we had some pretty significant crusades, services. And we were in this particular church where, I mean, the praise and worship was just absolutely astounding. Now, that's in 1975, when you probably the main instruments were a piano and an organ. I mean, here was this big church in Brazil that the worship was just at such a high level. And I was absolutely blessed because the musical instruments were, you know, guitars and all of these percussion instruments, not a piano or an organ to be found anywhere. Well, we'll look at that more next week. But the scripture very specifically states in Ephesians 5, 18 and 19, as well as Colossians 3:16, that we are to engage ourselves in the speaking and the singing of psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Let's look at Ephesians. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. James says, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. In the early church, song, praise, and joy abounded, even as it had in the days of old under David's tabernacle. Throughout the history of the church, the ministry of true worship has waned, or in many instances has vanished. But then God would send a time of restoration, and along with that restoration would be a new song of the Lord. In fact, you can go back and you can study the history of the church and the restoration of the church, and you will find that each move of God had its own distinctiveness. Maybe there was a part of the revelation of God, and all of these parts of the revelation made up the total restoration. And we're not there. We're not to the full state of restoration as a whole. I'm speaking of the church as a whole. But that restoration has been progressive, and that has been the progression of revelation. That it's been, I believe, it's been line upon line, precept upon precept. It's been revelation on top of revelation. And really, the revelation was to go back and to restore to the church what had vanished. But with every move of God, there has been a specific song of the Lord. I mean, it's, you know, once upon a time, some of our so-called mainline denominations, or what we would call high church, and I guess that'd be Lutheran, I'm speaking of Protestantism, Lutheran, Presbyterian, even Methodists. You know, Methodists are considered to be very formal now. I mean, once upon a time, these churches were vibrant and alive. They represented in their day, especially in their inception, they represented really what God was saying at that particular time. And there was a song of the Lord that was associated with each. God is turning the captivity of Zion. You recall, I think it's Psalm 137, that the children of Israel were in bondage. They were in captivity in Babylon. And they were asked to sing a song of Zion, but they were downtrodden, they were depressed, because they were in bondage. And they said, how can we sing the song of the Lord in a strange land? We hung our harps upon a willow tree. But then the scripture says, therefore the redeemed of the Lord shall come with singing unto Zion, and everlasting joy shall be upon their head. So when the Israelites were released from Babylonian bondage, they again sang the song of the Lord. So the whole point being that when you're set free, you have something to sing about. Now, of course, I understand also that when you're in captivity, if you have a song in the night, the prison doors can swing open. I mean, that's what happened to Paul and Silas, right? God is turning the captivity of Zion. God is once again giving us a new sound and a new song. Each visitation of God pointed toward the true temple, and that is the house of God, the building of God, which we